Hi, I'm Steve Lukather for Starlicks, and today I'll be playing a number of my licks and solos and demonstrating some of the different techniques that I use. But before we get started, I'd like to tell you a little bit about my equipment. This particular guitar right here was made for me by Mike McGuire at Valley Arts Guitar, who's made several guitars for me, and they're all custom made to my specifications. This is a quilted maple top, and I use a gold Floyd Rose tailpiece and nut. And right here I've got EMG pickups that were wound for me special at the factory. I've always had a real good relationship with these people, and I really like these pickups a lot. And I spent a lot of time trying to find this piece of wood and everything like that. You know, we went through a lot of different guitars. I mean, a lot of different bodies. And I found that, for me, this stuff works great. I have several guitars, something like, I don't know, just a lot of guitars. And I like old Les Pauls, old Fender stuff, and so I've used some Ibanez stuff. But for me, I've grown really attached to this particular guitar right here, just because it's very versatile. I have my single coil pickups here, and I have my double, you know, like my humbucking type right here, which I use for like the more distorted sounds. And this is for like the cleaner rhythm things, you know. I really like that like old Axis Bold as Love sort of style that Jimi Hendrix used to use. Through the years, I've experimented with a lot of different equipment and a lot of different amplification and effects and whatnot. And right now, the setup that I have now was designed by Bob Bradshaw, who's currently on the road with me, working very closely, and as we speak, improving my gear. Because this is a kind of process that always never ends, you know what I mean? For me, every time I buy a piece of gear, the next day something comes out that's a lot better and a lot cheaper. So this is one of those things I'm sure everyone out there has dealt with. You know, you don't want to rush out and get the newest piece of gear because you're afraid that 2 days later it's going to be outdated. Some of the gear that I've been using here, right now I have all these effects. And I'm running everything. It's a stereo system, and I have a clean system, which is basically these boogie tops over here. These big, I believe they're 180 watts a piece, are like my basic sound. And that's the setup real clean. And the reason why I have that much power is so that when I play loud, I don't break up. You know, I don't get this, you know, unwanted distortion, not the kind of distortion that we would normally use to get a good sound. It's a different kind of distortion. And I use this boogie top right here, this 100 watt top, like almost like a gigantic glorified fuzz tone, because it doesn't go to a speaker system. It has load resistors in the back, which, you know, so if you don't have a speaker system to go to, you blow the top up. I process a lot of my effects through this Rain splitter mixer, and I can assign and adjust the level, and I can pan my effects either left, right, center, or in between there. You know, like if I'm panning it using an echo effect, like this, I'll show you. You're not hearing in stereo right now, but I realize that. But if you were sitting in this room right now, you'd hear the echoes cross. And if they're set at a different level, like one slow and one a little faster, it widens the sound a lot. I happen to love grease on my guitar, grease being effects and whatnot. Just because, you know, when you're hitting one note, you know, it sustains and sounds real good. Like in a recording studio, you would add these effects, like reverb and whatnot. Just, you know, a lot of your favorite records, I'm sure the guitar players, like, you use a lot of these effects, and you've heard them or you experiment with them yourself at home. This stuff is necessary to reproduce live what you would do on an album, and that's why I have so much of this gear. I mean, it's not a necessity to be a great player by having a bunch of great equipment, because that doesn't mean anything. You can have, like, just a box with strings on it and be a great player. I happen to toy with this stuff just because I love to toy with it. Here's a little demonstration. Right now I'm using, on this particular sound, I'm using the CS5 made by Ditronics. It's a tri-stereo chorus, which has three choruses in it in one. You have a chorus on your right side, you have a chorus on your middle, and a chorus on your left side. As well as what you just heard, I'm using two Roland 3000 digital delays, set at different speeds, varying on the song that I would do. But I, as a rule, I always use all this stuff just because, I mean, I've used it on the records and I just like the way it sounds. You could use different things. There's different delay units out there. I mean, you know, everybody has their idea of what the best stuff is. This is just stuff I've gone through the years, and I've used the Ibanez stuff. Their effects are real good. Eventide. This is a digital reverb, an MXR digital reverb, which I found for the money for what I need live. Most of the time in the studio, I would use whatever the reverb they have there, because usually they have great EMT plates or, you know, EMT digital stuff, or the AMS stuff is really good too. But some of that stuff is just ridiculous and unaffordable to take out on the road. Because, you know, $10,000 for a reverb, you know, it seems a little silly for a guitar player. Like, if you're a vocalist, you know, that's another story. Or if you just want to piss away your money, that's fine, too. You can do that. I have done this. This is why I'm telling you not to do that. The system I'm using here on the floor was designed by Bob Bradshaw. It's a very versatile setup, and it has 9 banks of 4 preset. It's like digital memory. So in other words, I can program any different effect. If I hit one button, I can change, radically change the sound. Instead of usually like where you have to like jump on like, you know, like all over the place here like this, trying to change your sound from like a hip lead sound to a rhythm sound. This way you only have to hit one button to go from your clean sound and then to your dirty sound and whatnot. Any other effects that you want to add, like additional like distortion. Or, you know, some of the other things. I have an old Univibe in here, which is pretty much outdated, which I've affectionately renamed the Sex Box. Don't ask me why, I just have a weird sense of humor. But all this stuff is just for the ease of and expediency of playing live and making this stuff work. And in the studio, too, going from a clean to a dirty sound. In case any of you guys out there want to play along, I'm going to give you a couple of tuning notes just to play. Here's an E. B, G, D, A, and of course the ever low E. Now if your guitar sounds like this, you have not tuned up properly. If it sounds like that, it's close. If you want to take out the accompanying manual that comes with this, the Starlix, the famous Starlix booklet, we'll begin with lick number 1. That was the solo from Rosanna off of our 4th album. And what that demonstrates to me, and maybe to you, is that I'm starting out playing something very simple and I'm trying to build it to an ending. So I start out low, down on the low F, or not the lowest F, but the octave above the low F. And I'm building up to what ends up being the high F when I slide off and you hear the echo. And what I'm trying to do is there's only one part of the solo where, you know, there's any kind of technique involved at all, and that's just getting from this low A right here to the high F right here. I'm bending up. The highest note that I hit is this bend right here. So let me play it slowly for you. This is lick number 2. This is from the end vamp of Rosanna, which all went down live on the date. Here, I'll play it for you. Okay, in contrast to the other solo, the middle solo, this one was more blowing. The other one was a little more worked out. Now this one demonstrates some of the wider bends and whatnot, and also shows the use of chromaticism getting from the high part to the low part. The bend is like this, you know, it's a major third bend. Okay, let me play the whole thing slowly. This is lick number 3. This comes from a song called Lovers in the Night off of our 4th album. This is like the end vamp solo. And this demonstrates the use of the Wang bar and some artificial harmonics, pick harmonics, in other words. And also, I kind of, you know, have a couple of cliche blues licks in there that I'm trying to just kind of cover up. But they seem to work in some areas. I mean, the standard vocabulary for guitar players, I mean, you know, all guitar players use blues licks and stuff like from the old Clapton Blues Breakers days and whatnot, and all the blue, the early black blues players that, you know, that those guys got their stuff from. Okay, before I play this slowly, I just want to point out a couple of key things. The first being, you know, the way I'm using the Wang bar here, I'm kind of really jerking it around a lot. So it goes... Anyway, another thing here is the classic blues lick that everyone knows, which is... And also we have the artificial harmonic back here, and with the Wang bar going down. Right? Sorry about the buzz, but I'm sitting right next to my amps, you know? Now, this is lick number 4. This comes from a song called Carmen off our new record, Isolation. And here it is. In this particular sequence, it's a little more scale-oriented than some of the other things that I've done just for the mood of this particular song. These in particular, where I go, that part, and also this part, the a lot of it is a repetition. I start the pattern, then I repeat the pattern, go one note lower, and so on and so forth. So here it is, and I'll play it slowly for you one time. This is lick number 5 from a song called Lion off the Isolation album, and this is pretty much how it goes. This demonstrates the use of the Wang bar to get a real ugly sound. You know, a lot of times you have this typical use of it, which is just hitting a harmonic, and which is how most people use it. But this is what I did here, was I hit this harmonic right here. And I can see where my strings are flying off the neck. That's because I pushed it all the way down to where there was no tension on the strings. So I'll show you again real slow. This is lick number 6. This is an excerpt from a song, Angel Don't Cry, off the Isolation album, and this demonstrates a double picking technique, which is harder to play at a slow speed, because you sort of have to loosen the wrist a little bit like this, and then that's a whole key to playing fast, I think, in a lot of ways, is keeping a very relaxed arm. If you stiffen up your arm, it's going to make it harder to move. An exercise you can use for developing your double picking is you take just, it doesn't even matter, you don't even have to play a scale or anything like that. You can just like take your hand to start. And just keep getting faster and faster. And you just work up at your own pace. I mean, you know, just every day when you're sitting around watching TV or something like that, you can just sit around and you don't even have to pay attention to what you're playing. The notes don't even matter if you want to develop your right hand. Just even a major scale or something. And then you can just work up to it, you know. Okay, this is an excerpt from the song Angel Don't Cry. I'm going to play it slowly first so you get an idea of what I'm trying to do, because there's a double picking technique to it. It's going to sound totally different at a slow speed as opposed to the regular speed. And here it is slowly. And here it is up the tempo. Okay, I'm going to show you something that'll embellish upon the idea of the double picking stuff. And this is somewhat similar to the end of a song called Girl Goodbye, which is on our first album. Okay, I know this lick sounds a lot more impressive than it really is. It's basically a very simple scale. And a lot of the key to it has to do with where you put the accents and where you come back when you're starting the scale, and you come back and kind of repeat the second half of the scale, and then you keep building up and up until you're all the way up the neck, and there's a slight bit of chromaticism up here where I'm going like towards the end of the lick. So I'll go over it kind of slowly. This is basically what it is. All the double picking stuff is like, you know. So what you do, the easiest way to build up to that kind of speed is just to kind of start, take a real simple lick, you know. This is like kind of an Al Di Meola style lick. You know, where like just even on the low strings, you can go like this, you can go. You know, that sort of a thing. And just try to build up to it as fast as you can, you know. Sometimes it'll take a while to do it. I sat in my room for a long time, you know, when I was younger, and did nothing but listen to Mahavishnu records and Return to Forever records, Al Di Meola, John McLaughlin, and all that sort of stuff. And just wanted to be like the fastest guitar player in the world, which I find now is cool to have the technique, but it's relatively meaningless when it comes to making melodic music, pop kind of stuff, like what I've done in the studios and what I'm trying to do with the band. Although I do realize it's important to have some flash and some technique behind whatever style you're trying to emulate, your own style or anybody else's style that you like. Okay, this is lick number 8. Now this is just going to be a short little lick here to show you, just give you an idea of a lick for something like on an E minor chord, let's just say for an example, showing a pedal tone kind of thing, the B being the pedal tone, and just working off the 9th, the 3rd, and the 5th. It's a real simple thing, so like if you hear a chord like the... over that chord, you can play this, and I'll play it again slowly. This is lick number 9, and this is pretty much the beginning part of the Breakdown Dead Ahead solo that I did for Boz Scaggs back in 1979. So it might sound a little different right now, because it's 1985. Yeah, this particular lick is pretty much blues stuff, but I'm playing off the 7th a lot, which is the F in this particular case in the key of G. I'm also goofing around with the 6th right here, which is the E, and bending like that. So I'll try to play it for you slowly. Another interesting aspect about the end of this particular solo is the way that I'm pulling off and using the open strings as a pedal tone. So I'll give you the end part of this solo slowly. Okay, this is lick number 10. This is the middle part of that particular solo, which demonstrates some chromatics and a couple of slide tricks that I stole from Larry Carlton. Okay, now I'll do this for you slowly. This is lick number 11, and this is from the song Hold the Line. This is an excerpt from the middle part of that solo, which demonstrates some of the wide bending technique. Okay, this particular lick demonstrates the vibrato, which is a very wide vibrato, and also bending from one note to the next in the middle of a bend. So I'll show you what I mean, like from here. That particular bend, the way I'm bending from that, and also the vibrato that I use afterwards. So I'll play it for you slowly one time. Okay, that's the first part of it. And I'll show you the second part of it now. All right, and then what you do is, and then you kick into the double picking part, which goes. Okay, this is lick number 12. This comes from a song called Mama off our second album, Hydra. And this is just a sort of like a melodic exercise, which also shows the B pedal tone here, which is a different way of showing the lick that I showed you before in the key of E. Now I'll play it for you slowly without the harmonizer. This is lick number 13 from Mama. And this also, towards the end of this, demonstrates like the blues aspect of this particular solo, and also the pedal tone of it towards the beginning of it. Here's the same lick done slowly. Okay, right here, this is lick number 14, which I'll just demonstrate a couple of cheap wang bar tricks, which you probably already know, but in case you don't. This is kind of actually almost a Hendrix kind of thing, you know, which is where you're taking like your a blues lick, you know, playing two notes at the same time, which goes something like this. Right, and what you do is you add the wang bar to it, like moving it real radically, so it sounds something like this. Just to get as an effect. And some of the other ones, which you probably already know, are just the natural open harmonics that you have, which you can do, like take this G right here. Here's your regular G, and then here's the octave up here. And if you notice, like with the echo on the amps, it really causes, it's a real neat effect, the way it throws, the echo throws itself across each speaker, right? From the right to the left, which you probably can't hear on the little speaker that you're listening to this out of, but imagine it if you could. There's another way you can use the wang bar. Instead of going down, which is the normal way to do it, you know, all that sort of stuff, is to start with it down already and hit your pick harmonic and all that sort of stuff. Okay, here's something that's a little different. I mean, this is an example of using fourths as intervals. But it's like taking it in and outside the actual scale of, like, let's say if you're in the key of E, and you hear something, you know, you can make it rub a little bit more, and it just kind of throws people off. A lot of jazz players use this going in and out of the scale. You know, a lot of progressive fusion-type music, they use scales like this where everybody plays in unison. And you get, it's a real neat effect. I'll just give you, you know, like, kind of an example of a scale. Here's that lick slowly. Lick number 16. This, I'll show you a way to go from a C major chord to an E minor chord. Just by bending and sliding through the changes, you know, right here. This is a little different way to approach it here. Now here it is again, slowly. This is lick number 17 in the key of E minor, showing triplet arpeggios up to the high E. Here we go. The whole concept behind using arpeggios, or like, you know, chord shapes, is like, you know, that defines all the chords and all the chord changes that you would play through, even in jazz and whatnot. Like, this is a thing I remember Larry Carlton saying that really made sense to me. Was about how he, when he thinks of a scale, he doesn't think linear, he thinks in chord clusters. Like in Kid Charlemagne, when he does that and all that stuff, you know, that's you're looking at like an F sharp chord cluster, you know what I mean? To get you in and out, you kind of weasel your way in and out of the chords. This is just a simpler way to kind of give you an idea of what an arpeggio is. But what I'm trying to say is, like, arpeggios, it's a lot easier and more melodic if you think of chord clusters as opposed to scales, because scales start sounding like scales, and if you think of like whole like triads, moving them up and down, and like a half step down, sneaking them up, you know, you can get some really weird kind of sounds. And yeah, I think you can experiment for yourself and just check that out. Here's that triplet lick, slowly. In case you haven't noticed, I do a lot of sliding in and out of things. I think that using it as a point of expression or a breath, like a horn player would use when they leave their space in between phrases. You know, like what I mean, like this. All those sort of things. Now, I've switched to a clean sound for this particular lick, because this is going to demonstrate a whole other technique, something that I've learned. It's not my own technique or anything like that. It's more in the styles of Ted Green, Lenny Bro. It was taught to me by Jay Graydon, a great guitar player in his own right. This demonstrates false harmonics, which are ones that are not naturally like any of those, right? This is like taking chord clusters and spelling them out using this finger and using this stuff an octave away. You understand? Wang bar for a little vibrato there, if you care to use that. And the whole deal with this is like you skip every other string, in other words, like this. And this was a technique I used on a song called Mama on our second album, Hydro. And we went something like this. Now here it is again, slowly. Okay, this is lick number 19, demonstrating the same technique except using pull-offs in the false harmonic sense. Okay, I'm going to start out playing it slow and build it up to speed. That way you can kind of get an idea of what I'm trying to do here. And that's also so that I can get an idea of what I'm trying to do here. So hang on a second. See, that's the idea right there. Okay, this is lick number 20, the final lick. And what's happening here is I'm just going to show you a real flash kind of way to get from the top of the neck to the bottom of the neck to the low E. So here we go. Here's the lick slow. Thank you. know the rest. The last little bit of this, I'm going to, you know, put together a couple little things and just play some of the ideas that I played and then some and go through a couple of different things and see what you think.
We'll be right back.